And do you want to show that source thing first thing, or what?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I might as well get it so everybody has it through the discussion. I was telling Doug earlier that through links of Wikipedia, I was able to find the documentary hypothesis laid out in colors. And stick that up here. I put the link, if you scroll up in the chat, it's there. So I'm going to click my own link. Okay. This is the King James color-coded to the documentary hypothesis. They've got all five of the Pentateuch. Excuse me. Or you can look at each individual source in isolation, so you could read the continuous J source, the continuous E source, P source, that kind of stuff. So it came in handy when I was reading it because it seems to be very close to Wellhausen, so it matched up pretty good with the text as I was reading it, whereas other things like Friedman and Eisfeld, they're a little bit further down the chain, the food chain, towards modern times, so there's been differences. But this, from wherever they got it, whoever created it, it's very close. So.
Cool. Yeah, that's a handy resource.
So hopefully anybody watching the video might be able to see that clear enough. I'll leave it up there for a while.
I don't see it right now.
Yeah, I know. I haven't actually shared it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, this is especially relevant to... I'll do the intro thing now. Chapters 5 and 6 of the book we're reading, Legends of Genesis by Hermann Gunkel. And this is... Chapter 5 is titled Yahvist, Elohist, Jehovist, which is his name for the redactor, and the later collections. And chapter 6, which goes over the priestly codex and then the final redaction of J-E-M-P. And these chapters are pretty detailed. He gives a lot of examples of the different characteristics of the sources. And it's good to have a resource like what John linked with Genesis and with all the sources, so you can kind of reference everything he's talking about. So anyway, for those of you... Hey, Sean is back. Welcome back. So for those of you that did all or some of the reading, did you have any general thoughts before we dive into it about the content of the last two chapters?
I did, but it was more towards the end.
Okay.
But if you want, we can just... Well, basically, well, one thing I noticed was that they mentioned the Deuteronomist. Later writers saw the Deuteronomist hand in Genesis in a couple places. So just bear that in mind, that some people actually changed their mind on that. But I know that Gunkel at that period specifically mentioned that there was no Deuteronomist material there. Another thing was the last part, the priestly evaluation. You notice how negative he was about the priestly writer?
Yes.
Yeah. I thought it was very much a person of his time. You know, it seems like he favored the older legend type, the legendary material, and thought of the priestly caste and the evolution of religion as being like more backwards than anything else, which kind of fits his era, where, you know, there was a rejection of priestly concerns of through the Protestant Reformation. Mm-hmm. Would insist on that. So you can tell that they're very much a person of their time. Now, I was reading some other stuff by other authors, and a lot of them accused these guys heavily of anti-Semitism. And although, you know, you can actually find some actual, no denying, anti-Semitism, You know, it just seems to me that they're overplaying it in order to discredit these people, because if you, it's like calling mythicists Holocaust deniers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you label them with something very disparaging, that discourages people from taking it seriously. And there's a lot of things in source and form criticism that, you know, have been detrimental to evangelicalism and fundamentalism, so you can understand why they're willing to do that.
Not just that, but also it's been very threatening and detrimental to Judaism. I mean, if the documentary hypothesis is true in the form it's been described, then you can't really say that Moses, you can't really go along with a Mosaic authorship. So obviously that's a big issue too. I didn't sense any anti-Semitism in this book at all, though.
Yeah, why would these guys be that interested in evaluating this material and putting so much effort into it if they, you know, hated Jews? You know, it just doesn't make any sense to me anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't see the anti-Semitism either, so.
But I do hear a choo-choo train.
Dr. Price must be here. Well, I was listening to the Parsha, the last one on the beginning of Genesis.
Parsha Bereshit.
Yeah, and it's, I was just listening. I wasn't participating, but it's just amazing how many different points of view come into play. And almost all of them, you probably noticed, involved a lot of reading into the text, where they're going into stuff that, you know, it's what it has to mean in order for my theology or my theory to be correct. That's a lot of that. I mean, the majority of it was like that.
Yeah. One thing I've learned going to those, this is kind of a side issue, but one thing I've realized going to those hangouts is Noahides and observant Jews are just as much apologists as evangelical Christians, seems to me.
Yeah.
And it's not, shouldn't really be surprising, but anyway. All right, you guys want to dive in?
Yes, let's do the point by point.
Okay. So yeah, last two chapters, and this is the end of the book of Legends of Genesis. So chapter 5, Yahvist, Elohist, Jehovist or Redactor, and the later collections. So the first point he makes in chapter 5, he talks about... he thinks that these different sources aren't weren't written by the hand of a single author, that they were, the J and E are really just collections, gradual collections over time of materials put together. So he doesn't even like to call them authors, he calls them collectors, so to speak. Let me go through some of my notes. What did you guys think about that in general? Because I thought that was interesting.
Yeah, I think he's definitely right on that.
John,
like, I have a lot more respect for Gunkel now that I've read or heard the entire book now. When I was first, you know, the first couple of chapters, I was really skeptical, but he sold me through it.
Cool.
Anyone else? I was going to say something, but I thought... I don't want to keep hogging up anything.
No, don't worry about it. Go ahead.
I, from working with these sources, you know, intimately, I understand where he was coming from because I had read some of the earlier stuff in the book and jumped back in order to find out what the heck he was talking about, because a couple times it seemed to be a little bit based on what he had said earlier. But for the most part, I think he's right that, say, like, the Yahwist and the Elohist were pretty much just putting their sources in as they found them with very little redaction. But occasionally I thought that I would see that there was some kind of rewriting. And later on in the Polychrome Bible, which I showed you earlier, they have the J1 redactor, and I think they might have a J2 redactor. So each one of those, they came to recognize later on, the source critics anyway, that there was actually some editing going on, so they weren't 100% collectors. But I think at the time of Gunkel, that wasn't really recognized fully. And even if he was party to that, he might not have even agreed with it, because he saw the evolution of this body of literature as he was trying to get away from it as literature, but towards more recorded traditions. So when it comes down to be written, you have to look at it as a whole, its impact as a whole, and you're not going to get anywhere by atomizingly tearing it apart into sources. It's not really going to tell you anything from Gunkel's point of view. It seems to me what he was arguing, that he's looking at the big picture, what they are, you know, finding out what these things are, traditions from wherever they came from. And when they landed onto the ears of the Israelites, or the eyes of the Israelites who are reading them or listening to them, that's what was important.
Right.
I don't want to repeat everything I said in a different hangout, but regarding Genesis 1, which is supposedly from the Peace Source, I see obvious evidence there that it's based on an earlier source that did not have the days numbered.
You know what? There's a few things I want to go over with you, Wayne, later on. We don't have to do it during the live part. But if we do, there's a couple of things that I found out that might be of interest to you.
Yeah, that would be nice. I also reorganized my chart to put the columns in a more logical order, and it actually shows the pattern better and shows a couple of the exceptions better.
I have to take some head medicine. I'm starting to get a headache. I'll be right back.
Okay. So yeah, the sources as collections. I thought he mentioned at some point, I could be wrong, that he thought J and E did do a little bit of editing themselves, but it was very little. But again, I could be misremembering that. He says, this is at the beginning of chapter 5, the collection of the legends in writing was not done by one hand or at one period, but in the course of a very long process by several or many hands. We distinguish two stages in this process, the older, to which we owe the collections of the Yavist, designated by J, and the Elohist, designated by E, and then a later, thorough revision in what is known as the Priestly Codex, which he'll deal with that in chapter 6. And then to kind of back up his claim there, he says the fact that they have adopted such heterogeneous materials, J contains separate legends and legend cycles, condensed and detailed stories, delicate and coarse elements, primitive and modern elements, and morals and religion, stories with vivid antique colors along with those quite faded out. It is much the same with E, who has, for instance, the touching story of the sacrifice of Isaac, and at the same time a variant of the very ancient legend of Jacob's wrestling with the angel. This variety shows that the legends of E, and still more decidedly those of J, do not bear the stamp of a single definite time, and still less of a single personality, but that they were adopted by their collectors, essentially as they were found. So yeah. And then he goes on to kind of distinguish the different characteristics of J in comparison to E. He says that J often tends to contain the older version of a legend or a story. And then he gives examples of the story of Hagar in J is older than the lachrymose version of E. The story of Jacob and Laban is told more laconically and more naively by J than by E. In the narrative of the birth of the children of Jacob, J speaks with perfect frankness of the magic effect of the mandrakes, instead of which E substitutes the operations of divine favor. In the story of Dinah, J, who depicts Jacob's horror at the act of his sons, is more just and more vigorous in his judgment than E, where God himself is compelled to protect Jacob's sons. In the story of Joseph, the Ishmaelites of J are older than the Midianites, of E, who afterwards vanished from the account. In the testament of Jacob, his wish, according to E, to be buried beside his best-loved wife is more tender and more sentimental than his request in J to rest in the tomb with his ancestors. And then there are other similar cases, too.
Yeah, that holds up really well, because I was going through the thing on Wikiversity.
Mm-hmm.
And you could see that what's the E has a definitely sentimental twist to it, where, you know, people weep, that kind of stuff, almost exclusively. But then I'm starting to think, well, if that's what you're looking for, we're going to assign what I think belongs to E and what I think belongs to J. So just how much of this source criticism is in the eye of the beholder, considering that there's so many different ways of actually dividing up the material. There's somewhere everybody agrees
that
something might be a source, but then there's a lot of subjectivity, too. I don't know. You know, sometimes I wonder.
Yeah, there is both, but the evidence for the documenting hypothesis as a whole does not come from the ability to line sources up a certain way in any particular criteria, but it's the fact that when you do a bunch of different criteria, they all coincide to basically the same thing going on.
Yeah, the valid point is that there are clearly sources. Wherever you want to draw the line between one and the other is arbitrary, but there are sources, it's clear.
Yeah.
Well, just to go off what Wayne was saying, it's not... I think you can go further than just saying that there are sources. I think there are systematic patterns within the different sources, like the name of God, how narratives are portrayed, whether they're sentimental or dry, or even certain vocabulary that they're using. Like later on, we'll talk about certain characteristic vocabulary and phrases that are tend to be. So when you take all these factors together, you see that hey, they're all present pretty much in these passages. And then all these different things are present in these passages. So yeah, on any individual criteria, it would be kind of circular, but when you bring a bunch to bear, I think it becomes a little better tool to really identifying sources. But yeah, then again, there's tons of wiggle room on a lot of stuff too.
One of the criteria that fascinates me the most, and the one criteria I'd love to discuss specifically in a future hangout, is that it seems like some of the prophets had access to like one of the source texts, but not the entire Pentateuch as we have it. So they'll quote just from the P, or just from E, or just from J, without quoting from the other sources, which seems really, really interesting. You know, one of the examples is Jeremiah quoting from P constantly, and I think Ezekiel, I forget whether it's J and E he quotes from, but all the time, but Ezekiel like rarely quotes from P, and Jeremiah rarely quotes from the other sources.
And there are some books that actually go into that in detail. Maybe a few hangouts we can deal with some of the more modern books on
that'd be great.
Hypothesis, because they go into a lot of that stuff there too. You know, it's very helpful is to read say even just articles on people that consider the documentary hypothesis debunked and no longer relevant or true, because it kind of helps you focus in on the areas, you know, where you might want to, you know, learn a little bit more, or, you know, go over the evidence a little bit better. But I think it still holds up even against those kind of criticisms, because one of the big criticisms is none of the criteria, you know, vocabulary, names of God, all this other stuff, you know, are holding up. But it does. It really does hold up. I think they just want to deny that it does for apologetical reasons.
Completely agreed.
Yeah. Okay, so he also mentioned this interesting thing. E does not yet know of the Philistines in Gerar, whereas J does. He places them there. The deception of Jacob by means of the garb of skins in E is more naive than that by means of the scent of the garments in J. And anyway, he goes through a bunch of different characteristics of J and E, so there's a little taste of what he's talking about.
excuse me, Doc. I'm going to look it up, but I saw an article that was written in the old thing called the Monist, M-O-N-I-S-T. It was a very popular journal back in the day. And when they came out with the Polychrome Bible, it went into a lengthy, something like 17-page discussion of it, which was really good. The first part of it you could skip, but what was good about it was when it's talking about all these contradictions and things that didn't make any sense, once you realize that they're from different sources, then it does make sense, you know, because you can now figure out why, you know, Isaac is on his deathbed when he's blessing Jacob and Esau, but he survives another, 15 years or so in order to be there when, you know, to be buried by the sons once they reconcile, you know, just those kind of things. Where there's all kinds of chronology problems that come up because, you know, both sources are incorporated and whoever's doing it doesn't really even care that they create these problems, you know, because they're more interested in getting all the information into it.
So the next part is when you were mentioning J123, I think Gunkel does acknowledge it, maybe not in the exact form of what you're referring to, but another section in chapter 5 is called the Yahvist Sources, and he says, in Jay's story of the beginnings, we distinguish three sources, two of which present what were originally independent parallel threads. It is particularly clear that Jay contains originally two parallel pedigrees of the race. Beside the traditional Cainite genealogy, a Sethite line, of which verse 29 is a fragment. In combining the two earlier sources, a third one was also introduced, from which comes the legend of Cain and Abel, which cannot originally belong to a primitive time. And he says that because, you know, Cain is afraid of getting killed by all these other people around and goes and builds a city and, like, where did all these people come from, you know? So he thinks that that story was anachronistically placed back at a very early time, and it actually wasn't ever meant to belong there.
Okay, there's a link to that Monist article.
Oh, okay, thanks. I'll put that on the Facebook, too, for anyone that...
Okay.
For anyone that wants it or wants to read it.
Yeah, it's entertaining. Not just informative.
So anyway, some of these things are... He goes over more things of why he thinks J is a collection, essentially a collection. And he thinks the same is clear for E, but he says there's not as much really clear evidence in the case of E, even though he does think that is the case for E. Yeah, he says, the whole process began in the stage of oral tradition. The first hands which wrote down legends probably recorded such connected stories. Others then added new legends, and thus the whole body of material gradually accumulated. And thus, along with others, our collections J and E arose. J and E, then, are not individual authors, nor are they editors of older and consistent single writers, but rather they are schools of narrators.
Yeah, I agree. There's probably no one-hand evidence here.
And he goes on to say, when it comes to identifying these different earlier sources, he says, from this point of view, it is a matter of comparative indifference with the individual hands, I'm sorry, what the individual hands contributed to the whole, because they have very little distinction in individuality, and we shall probably never ascertain with certainty. Hence, we feel constrained to abstain as a matter of principle from constructing a hypothesis on the subject. So, I guess that's his opinion on identifying the sub-sources of J and E, at least in any systematically reliable way. And then he talks about how he thinks that the collectors J and E were probably took a basically an approach of fidelity to their sources, trying to basically collect all this stuff as they found it, as it was passed on to them. But then again, he goes on and says that there was some remodeling, as he puts it. Now he starts comparing, he says, relation of Jahvist to Elohist. And he says that they weren't literarily related. They didn't, J didn't copy from E, E didn't copy from J. They're two totally separate streams of tradition, even though they contain a lot of the same narrative material. He says, the difference between them is found first in their use of language, the most significant feature of which is that J says Yahweh before the time of Moses, while E says Elohim. Besides this, there are other elements. The tribal patriarch is called Israel by J after the episode of Penuel, but Jacob by E. J calls the maidservant Sipha, and he's quoting Hebrew, so I'll probably mispronounce all of it. E calls her Amma. J calls the grain sack, I'm assuming that's from the
Joseph's story.
Yeah, Joseph's story. Sack or sock, and E calls it Amtahat, and so on. So using different vocabulary for the same item in a story.
I'm just wondering what people think of this thing. Is there's a lot of, say, like E only starts, say, around Abraham, doesn't have anything before that, supposedly. Mm-hmm. Maybe, because, well, it's not included anyway. There's other stories where they basically tell the same story with a little bit of different emphasis, and yet whoever compiled the Pentateuch is picking and choosing. They're choosing this part, maybe the earlier part from J, the later part from E. Do you think that E had that stuff and that they favored J, or didn't have it and it was supplemented with J material when they were putting it together? You guys have an opinion on that?
Can you give us the two options again? I missed the...
In J and E, there a lot of times they're telling the same story. So you'll have, say, like the introduction to the story might come from J, and then you'll have a long block of E, and then maybe the end of the story with J. Is it, why are they doing it that way? Is it because there's no E material at the beginning of the story, or they didn't like what they read and decided to use J for that part, and then use E for the part they did like? Those two options.
I don't know. I would personally, I don't really know that much about it, but I would personally think that whoever redacted J.E. probably just preferred a version of a particular passage, you know, even a little snippet of a longer narrative, say, preferred J's version rather than E, and would just selectively, if there was an overlap on the material. But who knows? Like you said, maybe J didn't have material and only E did. It's hard to say.
Or the other way around. Because if you read like the J source continuously and the E seems a little bit less, seems more fragmentary in a way. I don't know. It has less continuity. It just seems to me. But
yeah, it's hard to say. It is interesting, though, that we get a lot of doublets, too. I mean, are most of them repetitions by P of J and or E stuff, or do we even repeating the same things? I don't know. I haven't looked into the doublets as frequently.
Yeah, I haven't actually paid much attention to what's occurring and where.
Yeah, that might give you a hint as to what was going on there.
I'm pretty sure that Abraham and Sarah, both those occurrences occur in J, and then the third, where it's is Isaac and Rebecca, I think. That's E, I think. So.
Okay.
Like this. Where twice, E's. Twice it's Abimelech. in Gerar, but it's two different patriarchs. And there's the twice of Abraham and Sarah.
Yeah. Well, first, Abraham and Sarah first is in Egypt, and then it happens again with Abimelech, and then Isaac and Rebekah with Abimelech.
Right, yeah. And
so
I think
three times total that happens.
Yeah, I think it's two different sources. I could be wrong, but...
Yeah. I'd be surprised if it wasn't. But then again, it wouldn't be that surprising, because as Gunkel's telling us, you know, maybe Jay collected three different versions of that story, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, it's an interesting question.
Mm-hmm. And then he says, when you can't distinguish off of things like vocabulary, you have to go off of different variants between the two sources. He says, thus in J, Isaac is deceived by Jacob by means of the smell of, I think I already mentioned this, Esau's garments. And E, by the feel of the skins. And he says this difference runs through a great portion of both stories. Or we can observe that different stories have certain pervading marks, such as sold in J by Ishmaelites to an Egyptian householder, but in E, Jacob is sold by Midianites to the eunuch Potiphar. Another interesting difference there.
Yeah, it's quite a history of trying to record.
Excuse me, Potiphar was a eunuch?
That's a Gunkel saying.
Yeah, that kind of stopped me in my tracks a bit when I read that.
Yeah, I wondered about that, like, because later on he has a wife.
Well, the eunuchs were pretty prestigious. I mean, they were like, in the case of Potiphar, he's a big shot. So it would be an honor to be his wife, although that's probably why she was very interested in Joseph, probably. That's the joke of the situation, I think.
Yeah, I'll read more about that, why he thinks that.
He doesn't explain it, really. I think it's assumed because people know from Egyptology that particular office was held by eunuchs.
You know what's interesting too? Potiphar's wife tries desperately to seduce Joseph.
That's what I thought, the humor of it, you know.
Yeah. Oh, did you already say that?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Maybe I accidentally muted me, so. But when Shauna came on, I was saying that there's quite a history of beginning with the rabbis and stuff trying to harmonize just Joseph's being sold into slavery, because it sounds like first it says he's sold to Midianites, then he's sold to Ishmaelites, and they kind of mention it in passing. And so Joseph was sold to Egypt by the Midianites. So it goes back and forth. And some of the convoluted ways of harmonizing that I've read is really interesting. It's a fascinating study in itself if you ever get a chance to read something like that. I won't say where.
Sorry, I was getting
distracted. I think the redaction looks a lot like the work of a committee. That's why you get more than one version of these various things, and why you get pieces of one type part that have other things inserted in it. It's like, well, our group, we always heard and we know that it was Abraham whose wife was desired by the Pharaoh. And other people on the committee are like, oh, no, no, it was the other way. It was Isaac. And so, okay, guys, as we get together, we've got to put it together somehow. Let's just put both versions in. Maybe it did happen to both guys. And then they move on.
Well, that's an interesting point, because Gunkel says that these were all schools, but maybe there was a redactionary school as well, where you got a committee of people deciding how to put all this crazy stuff together. I mean, I didn't even consider that, but And maybe Gunkel didn't either, because he didn't really seem to go that far.
Yeah. He just talks about the redactor or redactors, possibly, of J-E. Not of just J, just E.
And a later redactor, too. Cause
yeah, once J-E and P were assembled, then someone redacted all that.
Yeah. But you have this impression you're only talking about two or three geniuses, you know, at the most. Not, you know, like Shauna says, maybe a committee of crazy people.
Possibly, yeah.
Maybe those crazy people were assembled during the Babylonian exile, and they were putting together the stuff that they remembered, and they just didn't even, maybe they didn't even have those manuscripts anymore, and they were working on memory or little pieces and here and there that some people might have had, and you know, and so they were trying to put together this one definitive version of the early legends in order to preserve them, you know, through the time of captivity, however long that might be.
What does Gunkel say about, doesn't he say something about P in relation to the exile? No, I can't recall what he said.
Oh, yeah, he does.
Wasn't he implying that P was a product of the exile, didn't he
say? Yeah, he does, yeah. And he said he thinks that the redactor of J.E.P. was probably represented by Ezra. Anyway, we'll get to that. But yeah, he does say that. So some more stuff about J in relation to E. He says, inasmuch as J the story of Joseph puts Judah in the place of Reuben, since he gives a specifically Judean version in the case of the legend of Tamar, and because he has so much to say of Abraham, who, it seems, has his real seats in Hebron and in Negev, which is southward of Judah, we may agree with many recent critics in placing the home of this collection in Judah. It has been conjectured, on the contrary, that E has its home in northern Israel. In fact, this source speaks a great deal of northern Israelitic localities, but yet at the same time, much of Beersheba. Furthermore, in the story of Joseph, E hints once incidentally at the reign of Joseph, and that's in chapter 37, verse 8. Though this too may be derived from the tradition, certainly it cannot be claimed that the two collections have any strong partisan tendency in favor of the North and South kingdoms, respectively. Now, did I read that wrong, or did he just contradict everything he said leading up to that final sentence of the paragraph? Because he goes on and... Oh, maybe Reuben says brainstorming. Yeah. It's like, here he is laying out the reasons why J should be from Judea, and here are some reasons why E should be from northern Israel, but then he says, actually, there's no partisan preference for either location.
Yeah, I noticed that. I thought, oh, contradiction.
A lot of stuff in this book seems to be contradictory, but maybe Reuben's right. Maybe he's just kind of tossing differing views around in his head to the reader.
Yeah, that's one thing.
Because he has a whole rest of the book in order to work it out, right? This is just the introduction.
Yeah, possibly.
Yeah, that was one thing that kind of caught me, is earlier in the book, he's talking about some of the tendencies that go on in Genesis, you know, not describing characters' mental states, but just showing them through action, things like that. But then in these chapters, he's saying that a lot of those considerations don't necessarily apply to P. I wish I would have known that at the outset, that he didn't think they applied to P.
Reuben says in the chat, perhaps we're looking at it in the wrong way. Isaac is more important than Jacob. That is why he is son of Abraham and Sarah, giving him two prophets as parents. And Reuben was saying he's just brainstorming, not Gunkel.
Yeah.
No, Isaac more important than Abraham. Didn't I say that? Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Isaac more important than Abraham.
Well, there's a lot of things he said about P that I personally don't agree with. Yeah, he does have a certain outlook. But, you know, there's also one example of P poetry in Genesis. So, you know, to characterize him as legalist, you know, not concerned with story and that kind of stuff. It's like he's very disparaging of P, maybe more so than he deserves, in my opinion. I'm just brainstorming.
Yeah.
Well, he is plainly later and is under deep suspicion of having made quite a few changes to the original material. And the writer of this book is really interested in the original material and would like to see what that was. And so you can't help but feel a little bit of resentment toward anyone who might have changed it along the way.
Yeah, some of Gunkel's own personal bias there. But there was something else he mentioned about P. Didn't he say that P was probably redacting material that wasn't even J&E? That he was redacting some other material than that was incorporated with J&E?
I don't remember him saying that, but I could be wrong.
I'll have to look that up, because that's what I thought. I could have just been misreading it.
Redacting, yeah. Just making it up and adding it in. I guess I could throw that possibility out there.
Yeah. Yeah, I got this. I know we're jumping ahead a little bit to chapter 6, but I agree with you, Shauna. I think his view was that P like adulterated J&E, and that's why he doesn't really seem to have a favorable view of P. He seems to like the older, more original form of the legends, and that's the impression I got from reading it. So more into chapter 5, this section, the age of the Yavis and Elohis schools. I'm just going to touch on this briefly. The question of the absolute age of J&E is exceedingly difficult. We, who believe that we have here to deal with a gradual codification of ancient traditions, are constrained to resolve this question into a number of subordinate questions. When did these traditions arrive? When did they become known in Israel? When did they receive essentially their present form? When were they written down? That is to say, our task is not to fix a single definite date, but we are to make a chronological scale for a long process. But this is a very difficult problem, for intellectual processes are very difficult in general to fix chronologically. And there is the further difficulty that blocks us in general with all such questions about the Old Testament, that we know too little about ancient Israel in order to warrant positive conclusions in the present case. Very many of the chronological conjectures of literary criticism, insofar as they are based only upon the study of the history of religion, are more or less unsafe. But then he goes on to give some decent reasons for giving some he thinks J was probably finished by a certain date and E was probably finished by a certain date. He thinks the Legends of the Patriarchs was done by about 1200. And he backs this up by saying the sanctuary at Jerusalem, so famous in the time of kings, is not referred to in the Legends of the Patriarchs. On the contrary, the establishment of this sanctuary is placed by the legends of worship in the time of David. The reign of Saul, the conflict of Saul with David, the United Kingdom under David and Solomon, the separation of the two kingdoms, and the war between them, we hear no echoes of all this in the older legends, a clear proof that no new legends of the patriarchs were being formed at that time. So that's just for the patriarchs. And then he has a section on remodeling of the legends. Where again he talks about how he thinks J and E may have kind of altered things a little bit to get the different legends to mesh together better. Any comments so far?
No, I thought that was interesting, though, that here you have stories that seem, you know, not connected with anything in history, but then you build an outline framework where you fit it into a chronological, quasi-historical view. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
And wouldn't that fit with a later group of people trying to put together some ancient manuscripts into one book and making it all coherent? Like during the Babylonian captivity. Sorry, but I thought I would go ahead and throw in the minimalist stuff to the, when we're talking about this.
Well, in 6, he kind of... Well, I don't know. I mean, does minimalism say that all this stuff was invented at the time of the Babylonian exile?
Well, it doesn't have to be invented in order to be, like, say, a compendium of earlier works that are were perhaps, say, burned when the temple was destroyed. And so when they went away, they just didn't have them anymore, and they're trying to put them all together and make one book that puts together the really ancient legends. And so, you know, since they're going to have this one book and they have all these legends, maybe they'll make them all fit together. And maybe there were some later details added for propaganda purposes from various groups for various reasons. But I guess that doesn't mean that it was just all invented and you know, out of whole cloth.
Yeah, I don't know. I kind of think that if they had lost everything and were trying to reconstruct it, seems to me like there'd be more unity in the documents as we have them. I mean, through up to chapter 5, Gunkel's talking about the difference in, you know, the older seeming legends and the later seeming legends and the literary differences between them and all this stuff. I think he has some good points with that. And I'm not sure if someone in the Babylonian exile was just recalling all these stories that you would have had such systematic patterns between
You find if you had a committee that was getting together all the various people who remembered the various legends or had various scraps of the books that they brought with them or for whatever reason, and you had a group of guys who were going to put out the approved version, because after all, you've got a couple of different strands going on, you know. Northern people remember the legends kind of differently from Southern people. And so if you want to get one book that fits it all together, you got to have representatives of all the groups there.
Yeah, that's a good point. And if they did have scraps, like papyrus scraps or whatever, and or extensive memorization of huge chunks, then yeah, I could definitely see that happening and still maintaining that these major systematic differences between the legends. I think that could be preserved while at the same time undergoing a process like what you're describing.
I have a hard time buying that. I actually feel more in agreement with your earlier skepticism. I think the document hypothesis doesn't merely have strong evidence that there are separate sources. It has strong evidence that there are separate written sources that had their own existence before they emerged together.
But if you have memorization of the written sources, that might overcome it. I don't buy that,
but maybe.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just saying it's a possibility. But yeah, I think clearly you're dealing with a collection of different written sources. But again, you know, Shauna said, you know, maybe they had scraps. For all we know, maybe it was in Babylonia where the northern and southern Judean people really had come together, and we're basically confronted with their different versions of all these stories, and they actually had their copies, and then at that time they, for whatever reason, felt compelled to unify them, you know, and this is what we've gotten as a result. You know? So maybe they, maybe, you know, they did actually have physical copies of all these different writings. Okay, so we did remodeling of the legends. And then he briefly talks about relation of the collections to the prophets. He's basically trying to contradict claims by others in his day that there's material in the sources in Genesis that they were saying were familiar, proved that they were familiar with the writings of the prophets. And he's basically taking them to task and saying that, you know, he basically disagrees with them and gives a bunch of reasons why he thinks their conclusions are faulty. There was one part I wanted to read and I forgot to highlight it. Yeah, go ahead.
You're saying that he's saying that instead of saying that Genesis used the prophets, he's trying to say it's vice versa, that the prophets used sources from Genesis?
Well, that I don't think he's necessarily addressing as an argument, though I wouldn't think he would disagree with it. But he, in his day, according to this section, there were authors claiming that the sources knew about the prophets. Okay? And he's trying to contradict them. He's trying to say, no, they didn't. There was one part I was wanting to read. Yeah, he says, many modern critics, but the assumption of many modern critics that this relation must be due to some direct influence of the prophetic writings is very doubtful in many cases. We do not know the religion of Israel sufficiently well to be able to declare that certain thoughts and sentiments were first brought to light by the very prophets whose writings we possess. Okay, so even if we find stuff that's similar in the prophets and in Genesis, it doesn't necessarily mean that the prophets were the first time in history where those concepts were, you know, discovered or invented or whatever. He says the earnestness with which the legend of the dead speaks of the universal sinfulness of mankind and the glorification of the faith of Abraham are not specifically prophetic. The hostility of the collectors to the images of Yahweh and to Asherim, which are sacred poles, of which they never speak, to the Masaba, if I'm saying that right, obelisks, which J passes over but E still mentions, to the golden calf, which was regarded by the legend, according to E, as sinful, as well to the teraphim, which the Jacob Laban legend Woodley ridicules. All of this may easily be independent of prophetic influence. Sentiments of this nature may well have existed in Israel long before the prophets. Indeed, we must assume that their existence in order to account for the appearance of the prophets.
Well, Reuben mentions also that there was a consideration that, say, Abraham and Sarah were both prophets already.
Yeah, he mentions that too. At least I thought he did. Yeah, true, E calls Abraham a Nabi, prophet. That is to say, he lived at a time when prophet and man of God were identical. But the guild of the Nabim was flourishing long before the time of Amos, and in Hosea also. Moses is called a prophet. Accordingly, there is nothing in the way of regarding E and J, both as on the whole pre-prophetic. So he's saying the material in E and J, rather than coming directly from the prophets, it sounds like it is, he's saying it's really just the soil from which the prophetic writings later came out of.
Very good.
That's his argument. I don't know enough about it.
It's towards the dating, though, you know. If you want to say that, there's no way that the prophets could have influenced Genesis in any way, but probably the other way around, or these are free-floating schools of thought or whatever. It places them in a relative position.
He goes on to, and on the same topic, he says, and while these collections contain nothing that is characteristically prophetic, they have, on the other hand, much that needs to be exceedingly... Sorry, I messed that up. They have, on the other hand, much that must needs have been exceedingly offensive to the prophets. They have, for instance, an especially favorable attitude toward the sacred places which the prophets assail so bitterly. They maintain toward the primitive religion and morality a simple leniency, which is the very opposite of the fearful accusations of the prophets. And he says, we can see from the prophetic redaction of the historical books what was the attitude of the legitimate pupils of the prophets towards ancient tradition. They would certainly not have cultivated the popular legends, which contain so much as heathen, but rather have obliterated them. In view of these considerations, we must conclude that the collections took shape in all essentials before the period of great prophetic writings, and that the touches of the spirit of this movement in J and E but show that the thoughts of the prophets were in many a man's mind long before the time of Amos. This conclusion is supported by a number of other considerations. The legend of the Exodus of Abraham, which glorifies his faith, presumes, on the other hand, that most flourishing prosperity of Israel. On the other hand, the most flourishing prosperity of Israel, sorry, and accordingly comes most surely from the time before the great incursion of the Assyrians. And pieces which from the point of view of the history of legends are so late as chapter 15, or as the story of the birth of the sons of Jacob, contain, on the other hand, very ancient religious motives. And he says, he puts J and E, perhaps J, perhaps in the 9th century, and E in the first half of the 8th. But he goes on and he emphasizes that these dates are very uncertain. Okay, so any comments so far? I'm gonna go to the last section of chapter 5.
None.
Okay. Oh, Reuben mentions... Oh, I think this is earlier in relation to Isaac being more important than Abraham because he was the son of Abraham and Sarah, two prophets. He says that Sarah was a greater prophet than Abraham. Okay, so last section of chapter 6 is called the Jehovist Redactor. That's just his term for the redactor, obviously. He says the two collections being J and E were united later by designated as RJE, so redactor of JE, whom, following Wellhausen's example, we shall call the Jehovist. So I guess Wellhausen labeled the redactor that too, I'm assuming.
Yeah, it seems like I wish I had read the entire
Prolegomena.
Yeah, I wish I had read that too, along with this book, because it would have helped, I think.
I'm assuming, based off of what he said there, that he must have called it that. Anyway, he goes on, this union of the two older sources took place before the addition of the later Book of Legends to be referred to as P. So he's saying J and E were combined into a single unit before P. So we would have to deal with that in the light of minimalism, I guess, because, well, maybe not. I don't know. I mean, it all comes down to whether you think J was Northern, or sorry, J was Judean and E was Northern, you know, that would play into it too, because if they actually didn't come together until the exile, then what were they doing already combined by the time you have JE and then P being combined by the last redactor in, during the exile?
Well, it would be, of course, then that, you know, everybody has their own spin on this, but it could also be that, you know, how late did that P redaction happen?
Yeah. Could have been very late.
Well, I think that minimalism recognizes that there may not have been a combined Solomonic kingdom, but there definitely was a northern Israel kingdom and a, maybe not so much a kingdom in the south, but once Assyria obliterated the northern kingdom, there was kind of like a economic boom there. So it might have actually rose to a higher material level from beyond city-states, maybe a little bit more organized than that. I don't think anybody ever claimed that there was an actual Judean kingdom that existed before the Babylonian attack. So it's not quite supposedly as the Bible depicts, but the point of having that, you know, saying a document was a northern document, supposedly in the kingdom of Israel, where they might have had the material culture in order to produce things like court records and that kind of stuff, that a lot of this material came south with the refugees, and that's an impetus. It acted as an impetus for the southern kingdom to write literature as prosperity happened in the region, because there was no longer any kind of competition with the northern kingdom. So that might have been the period where, you know, they're either the J source might have been written, and then there might have been enough time to redact it. Maybe not. Maybe both sources existed and then went into exile with the Judeans to Babylon. So then they were redacted there or after.
Hmm. Yeah, it's interesting. Could we ever even figure that out, or do we just have to make our best guess?
Well, the archaeology kind of backs up the version of history as presented by John just now. That they're, you know, they've actually found a lot of activity in that represents the northern kingdom, the early Israelite kings. You can find like palaces and various structures that show that there was really something going on there. But in the south, the archaeology shows a little more nebulous thing happening. According to this book I talk about a lot called The Forgotten Kingdom by Israel Finkelstein, he says that there's evidence that there was some kind of that a little bit farther south of Israel, but a little bit north of Jerusalem, there was some kind of a confederation that might represent what he calls a Saulide kingdom, which would be something that the stories of Saul might be representative of. And then, you know, you get all this activity at north, and then after the north falls apart because of the Assyrians, you start to see a surge in population, and, you know, the cities are bigger, and their buildings are more grand. There's more happening in Judah after the fall of Israel, which you can call through the various things that were left behind by the Assyrians and by the structures that they've been able to study. They've been able to uncover a lot of these buildings and sites and stuff that just weren't available to the man that wrote the book that we're reading right now.
Yeah, that's true.
Something that very interesting to look at is to look at the chronology of the northern and southern kings as recorded in the Bible side by side. It almost appears as if, you know, somebody deliberately used one to create the other.
Oh yeah, how often the in the early years the king of Judah will have a name that's almost exactly the same as the king of Israel.
Yeah, and they pretty much did the same things too. So that's what I think they wanted to construct a glorious past because they knew of one, namely the Northern Kingdom, but they really didn't have any material to go with other than what they managed to salvage or scrape together. And a lot of that stuff could have been constructed out of Assyrian records, Babylonian records too, that they might have had available in captivity.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's also a whole thing in minimalism about the possibility that a lot of the legends about David were actually inserted during the time of I guess it was the Maccabees, the Hasmoneans, that they were the ones who were looking to create this glorious past of the United Kingdom. And one of the things that kind of backs that up is the stories of David are very Greek in character, and you know might represent a Hellenistic source.
Wow.
There's some other things I wanted to speak about that too when we get into the P.
That's so late though, isn't it? I mean, you have the Septuagint being translated, what, 200 BC, and then the Hasmoneans started sometime around then, right?
Well, the Septuagint actually took place over a long period of time.
Yeah, if the legend means anything, it's that they translated the Pentateuch maybe at the most at that
point. Oh, that's right. Okay, yeah.
So the that's other books could have been added. Quite later.
But still, I mean, what's the current thinking on the writing of the, like, which books deal mainly with the kingdom of David and the stories about David in the Old Testament?
Samuel.
And Second Samuel, Kings, yeah. So when do scholars think they were probably written, right? Like, as of right now, where's the scholarship view on the dating of those documents? Do we know?
I think the conventional it's considered exilic or post-exilic at the earliest, but there's more radical thinking that places a lot of it in the Hellenistic period.
Okay.
Very few scholars consider that stuff was written contemporary with the events. That was the old fundamentalist,
Now, that doesn't mean that there weren't stories of David or some sort of a legend of a leader named David that already floated around amongst the people that was exploited by the Hasmoneans and put into this form for people to read.
Yeah, because there was some speculation that David might have been some kind of god, going through the process of being a demigod and then humanized. So. Yeah, I heard of David.
Reuben here says that the Septuagint was not completed before 30 BCE. Song of Deborah is the oldest, but most of the material of Joshua, Kings, and Samuel is 800 to 550 BC. Joshua is not necessarily prior to Kings, and Samuel, the Hebrew I've observed in Joshua is much later than J and E, so it can't be from the same time. Actually, this is not what Reuben's saying, but me personally, I think that Joshua might very well have been written as Persian propaganda for exiles that were returning to colonize the land. I it's just because I read it at the same time I was reading these theories of minimalism, and it just fits so perfectly that I think it might well be true.
You think that it was written by Persians?
Or written under Persian direction, yes.
Oh, okay.
Right. there's one another way to look at it too, is that Joshua might actually have been the Joshua mentioned in Chronicles or Ezra, Nehemiah. And that this is like just basically a romanticized version of what actually took place in the when the returners came back, that they actually had to subdue a lot of the cities that were resisting this imposition of a new ruling class over the area by the Persians.
And there was a high priest that was actually sent with some of the early exiles that was named Joshua.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of.
Reuben says, off of what Shauna said about Joshua possibly being Persian propaganda, he says that would explain the Samaritan version of Joshua. And he says Joshua is not his name. Hosea is his name. He could be modeled on the prophet. And he says the Samaritan version of Joshua and the version we have are very, very different. One influenced the other, Joshua the high priest.
Yeah, there's a plethora of theories. The dating issue is a hangout unto itself. So how far are we along? We're still in chapter 5, right?
I just saw something on Joshua here. I don't think it's that relevant, but he says Joshua's farewell from Joshua chapter 24, sorry, I hate Roman numerals, with its unconcealed distrust of Israel's fidelity is also in form an imitation of the prophetic sermon. So,
the P-influence thing?
He's talking about the Hexateuch here, because...
Yeah, these guys mainly dealt with the Hexateuch, not just the
Okay. Institute. Yeah, he says, in the succeeding books, especially the portion due to E, there's probably more of the same character, but in Genesis, the instances are rare. So now wait, if Joshua is truly Persian propaganda, and it's in one of the four sources, that would give us a lower bound for the dating at least, right?
Perhaps.
Well, I mean, wouldn't it have to?
Depends on when...
If the source contains... Oh, I guess it could have been added later, yeah.
Yeah, because Eisfeld breaks up Joshua into a whole bunch of different sources, too, J, E, P, and E, D. That's also that what he talks about there, the distrust of Israel's fidelity. A lot of that was later considered part of the Deuteronomic influence over the Pentateuch, so... That's been like a change of viewpoint since Gunkel's time.
Yeah, he's saying that it's an imitation of the prophetic of the prophets, basically.
Yeah, well, he was right that it was not that this was written so late as to for the prophets to have come first, and then they rifle the prophets for it's their viewpoint.
Yeah.
He's arguing for the opposite position, but people have said, "Okay, yeah, you're right," because it's not. We know exactly where it came from, and that would be like Deuteronomous influence.
Okay.
Deuteronomy being a Judan thing, right? That
I would place Deuteronomy post-exilic, but that's a radical view.
Yeah, that's a very radical view, because I think the regular minimalist view is that Deuteronomy was the book that was discovered when Josiah cleaned out the temple. You know, we say, quote, unquote, discovered. How it goes. It's been a while since I read that.
Yeah, but supposedly, even Margaret Barker goes into a lot of that, because that has a lot to do with the conflicts that she claims, you know, led into Christianity between the Deuteronomists as one school versus another school in theology of Judaism. But I'm saying, you know, because I view most of that stuff there as fictional, you know, to me that's just a way of backdating something that you wanted to appear legitimate by saying it was discovered before the exile by a righteous king Josiah, and he instituted all these great reforms. So, to me, that's propaganda.
It could be. Could be. Josiah, though, he was very interested in creating the monopoly for the cult in Jerusalem, was he not? And that would go along with having discovered all these wonderful books that are talking about how you shouldn't stray from the true path or all these horrible things will happen to you.
Yeah, but that could also be a later concern as well.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good one for churchmen of all ages, I guess.
Yeah, that's a big debate on that. Probably outside the scope of this hangout, though, that's the thing.
Ruben says, I don't think the Book of the Law is Devarim. That's like Parsha, right?
Yeah, well, I don't think it is either.
Yeah. I think it was a legal code. This is Reuben. I think it was a legal code that was later incorporated into the five books we have now.
Hmm. Yeah, I have an even more bizarro theory, but I won't go into it.
Yeah, let's finish up chapter 5 because it's already 9:30. Okay, so Yahweh's redactor, yeah. Yeah, that's basically all I had on it. He was saying he places the collector somewhere near the end of the kingdom of Judah. Yeah, this union of the two older sources took place before the addition of the later Book of Legends to be referred to as P. We may place this collector somewhere near the end of the kingdom of Judah. Okay, so chapter 6, Priestly Codex and Final Redaction. Any closing thoughts on chapter 5?
It's getting kind of late for me. It's like 11:30 here, so I think I'm going to have to call it a night.
Okay, no problem. Chapter 6 is pretty short, and you can watch it later if you want. It's up to you. But thanks for joining us for as long as you did.
Enjoyed having you here, Shauna.
Yeah, take care.
You're actually, I'm really enjoying this. I look forward to it on happening on Sundays. So I guess I'll see you guys next week.
Before you go, I'll post the reading for next week. And by the way, do you have a copy already of the book for next week? Or the PDF? Do you need a copy? If you need a copy, let me know.
I will be needing links and information on whatever we're going to be reading next week, and so you can, you know, post those somewhere or send them in a message to me.
Yeah.
That might be really good.
Yeah, I'll get in touch with you.
Yeah, we don't want to post it publicly.
Yeah, I'll get in touch with you. So anyway, and I'll post the reading.
We're friends on Facebook, right?
I think so. If we're not, I'll add you. But I'll get in touch with you tonight or tomorrow and get you straight up.
All right.
Get it all to you.
All right. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Okay, so chapter 6. This is where he starts bagging on the priestly writer.
Priestly writers. He kind of makes it clear that they are a committee.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
He says, this section. Sorry, go ahead. John.
I just reread that section where what Wayne was referring to, so yeah.
Yep.
I wanted to see that for myself.
He says, this source is so distinct from the other sources, both in style and spirit, that in the great majority of cases it can be separated from them to the very letter. Quite a claim. The priestly codex is of special importance for us because the entire discussion of the Old Testament was hitherto turned essentially upon its data. It is Wellhausen's to have recognized the true character of this source, which had previously been considered the oldest, to have demonstrated thus the incorrectness of that entire general view of the Old Testament, that is, that the priestly was the oldest. and thus to have prepared the field for a living and truly historical understanding of the history of the religion of Israel. The style of P is extremely peculiar, exceedingly detailed, and aiming at legal clearness and minuteness, having always the same expressions and formulae with precise definitions and monotonous set phrases, with consistently employed outlines which lack substance, with genealogies and with titles over every chapter. It is the tone of prosaic pedantry, often indeed the very style of the legal document. And in that particular case, he gives examples of chapter 11, and then 23, verse 17, 18. Occasionally, however, it is not without a certain solemn dignity, especially in Genesis 1 and elsewhere. The scene from, I think that's 47, yeah, 7 through 11, verse 7 through 11. One must really read the whole material P consecutively in order to appreciate the dryness and monotony of this remarkable book. The author is evidently painfully exact and exemplary in his love of order, but appreciation of poetry was denied him, as to many another scholar. Comments?
He goes on more in that vein for like the rest of the chapter.
Yeah, I'm just going to read some highlights. You guys can break in whenever you want. The only stories of any length which he gives us are those of the creation and the deluge, of God's appearance to Abraham, and of the purchase of the cave at Machpelah. All else is details and genealogies. He has a great predilection for genealogies, which, as we have seen, were the latest elements to be contributed to the accumulation of the legend, and which are in their very nature unconcrete and unpoetical. A very large portion of P's share in Genesis is genealogy and nothing more. So he loves genealogies. Even the accounts of the creation, the deluge, and the covenant with Abraham manifest a wide contrast with the vivid colors of the older legends. They lack greatly in the concrete elements of a story. Instead of this, P gives in them something else, something altogether alien to the spirit of the early legend, to wit, legal ordinances, and these in circumstantial detail. Another characteristic of P is his pronounced liking for outlines. This order-loving man has ensnared the gay legends of the olden time in his gray outlines, and there they have lost all their poetic freshness. Take as an illustration the genealogy of Adam and Seth. Even the stories of the patriarchs have been caged by P in an outline. Any comments? I'm gonna start really breezing through this.
What page are you on?
148. Oh, okay. I'm about to read from Importance Attached Chronology. So yeah, he one interesting thing I saw in here. He's saying that he, as a subset of his propensity to put everything in outlines, he likes to chronologically force things. So he says, it is not strange that the chronology of P displays everywhere the most absurd oddities when injected into the old legends. As a result, Sarah is still at 65 a beautiful woman whom the Egyptians seek to capture, and Ishmael is carried on his mother's shoulder after he is a youth of 16.
I read something elsewhere that's similar to that, but I can't think of, I didn't look at what sources it was from, but if you add up the dates and the genealogy of up to Abraham dying, you find out that Shem, Noah's son, would have still been alive. And it says that Abraham died, you know, after living a full life, you know, living like 175 years.
Yeah.
But his great-great-great-great-grandfather or whatever, you know, would have still been alive. It's just,
well, they did live a long time.
Yeah.
Ruben says, That's because Shem is Melchizedek. That's part of the story. Continuing, this is Gunkel. There has been added a great division of the world's history into periods, which P forces upon the whole matter of his account. He recognizes four periods. So one, from the creation to Noah, and then from Noah to Abraham, from Abraham to Moses, and from Moses on. Each of these periods begins with a theophany, an appearance of God, and twice a new name for God is introduced. He who is Elohim at the creation is El Shaddai in connection with Abraham, and Yahweh to Moses. At the establishment of the covenant, certain divine ordinances are proclaimed. First, that men and beasts are to eat only herbs, and then, after the deluge, that flesh may be eaten, but no man be slain. And then, especially for Abraham, that he and his descendants shall circumcise themselves, and then finally the Mosaic Law. So again, those four divine ordinances are proclaimed within those four main periods that he's divided everything into. So it would go from the creation to Noah, you have that men and beasts are to eat only herbs. And then you'd have from Noah to Abraham, that flesh may be eaten, but no man shall be slain. And then from Abraham to Moses, you have that Abraham and his descendants shall circumcise themselves. And then from Moses on, it's you get the Mosaic Law. And each of those main periods begins with an appearance of God, or is kind of christened with an appearance of God. Comments? Reuben says that he thinks the death ages of Abraham and Moses are meant to be symbolic. And are intended to be, I'm assuming, by the writers of the stories. Religious views of the priestly codex. It is characteristic of the religion of the author P that he says almost nothing about the personal piety of the patriarchs. He regards only the objective as important in religion. Here he goes on about how P views the patriarchs and a lot of the sacred sites described within, like the wells and forests and all these sacred sites where they're building shrines and stuff, that they're all that's basically heathen stuff, and he was trying to minimize that. There's one spot I did want to read. I'm skipping a lot. Yeah, it is evident that in this there is expressed a religious hesitation on the part of P to involve the supermundane God with the things of this world. It seems as though he suspected the heathen origin of these theophanies. So again, that would go along with Gunkel's earlier in the book designation or rule of thumb for identifying very old legends is, again, the immediate interaction of God in the world, whereas P, a very late, the latest, right, main source, would be God's very remote. He does not want to have, you know, super abstract, in a different realm, God mucking around on Earth.
I think it's also interesting that he kind of equates the earlier legends with possible well, he says heathen, but what we're really talking about is just Canaanite polytheism.
Yeah.
Well, I don't want to keep hashing this over and over and over again, but on my analysis of Genesis 1, it looks to me like originally God just spoke, and then things happen in response to that. But a later version of the story inserted God actually making things step by step.
But that would go against P, right? Because P doesn't like God to act in that way.
Exactly. That's why I mentioned it. That's why I think it's noteworthy here.
Yes. But isn't all that material in Genesis 1 labeled as P?
It's normally considered P, yes.
Oh, okay. And possibly the breaking of it into days, you know, maybe there was some earlier form of the P version where there wasn't even a division into days, and he put that in there.
I strongly agree with that. Yeah, from my analysis, that has to be the case.
Well, there's one thing I wanted to mention to you, Wayne, is that one theory was that the original version was a seven-day creation with man being created on the seventh day, which is why animals and man are crammed in on the sixth day, I think it is.
The problem is we have 8 + 1 stages. We have 8 stages, then plus the one more stage of God resting. So we have a cramming together, not just on the sixth day, but also on the third.
Yeah, so, the original story could have been completely different, but when it's being remodeled and reworked, it's no telling what kind of shifting around and moving around, adding and subtracting was going on.
Uh-huh. Anyway, my main point, though, is I think the original story had God just speaking and things happening in response, and that God taking direct action to make things happen was added to the story later, at a later stage.
So what happened to those later speakings?
Well, they're all there, but they're all like, God says, let something happen, and then it would have said, this happens thus. But then it says, and thus God made, what was changed to, instead of thus the earth. Because it says, let the earth bring forth beasts. But then it said, instead of next thing being, and the earth did bring forth beasts, it said, now God created these beasts. I think that was a change to the text at some point in time.
Yeah. Unless he's announcing unless God's just announcing his intention and then he's doing it. I don't know.
We have other instances of the let there be and then it just happening in response.
That's
still
true.
In the text, like on the third day.
Yeah. Or he doesn't actually have to fiddle.
Exactly.
It just happens because he spoke it. Yeah, interesting. Anyway, I'm going to trudge along through 6 because I want to finish up here. He identifies a lot of things as heathen. He says, but it is especially characteristic of P that he no longer refers to the sacred symbols, which had once possessed such great importance for the ancient religion, as may be seen particularly in the legends of the patriarchs. In him, we no longer find a reference to the monuments, the trees and groves, and the springs at which, according to the ancient legends, the divinity appeared. P has expunged all such matter from the legend, evidently because he considered it heathenish. I love that word. Here we see plainly the after effects of the fearful polemics of the prophets. It is the same spirit which branded the ancient sacred place of Bethel as heathen in the reform of Josiah, and which here rejects from the ancient legends everything that smacks of heathenism to the children of a later time. So yeah, he's definitely coming down hard on P. Does not like how P has fucked up the earlier legends, in his opinion. And then he says, P has whitewashed the history of cleaned up, made more presentable to his liking, the presentation of the patriarchs. He says, what pains had been taken to eliminate at least the most offensive things in this line so far as possible. When it comes to P, at last, He makes a clean sweep. He simply omits altogether what is offensive. For instance, the quarrel of the shepherds of Abraham and Lot. Lot's selfishness, the exile of Ishmael, Jacob's deception, etc., etc. He even goes on to the length of maintaining the precise contrary to the tradition. Ishmael and Isaac together peacefully buried their father, and so did Jacob and Esau. Facts which cannot be obliterated receive a different motivation. Thus he explains Isaac's blessing of Jacob as a result of Esau's sinful mixed marriages. And he lays the crime against Joseph at the door of the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. He says P. dealt very arbitrarily with the traditions as it came down to him, felt free to edit and change them for his purposes. Gives more examples. And he says, in contrast to J and E, who are pretty much really just collectors, P, he feels, was generally an author in that he added to, heavily redacted, edited, etc.
Okay, stop right there.
Okay.
The bottom of that paragraph, which is at the top of page 154.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I was asking about earlier. He says that he's, you know, what you were talking about earlier, that he is changing things to suit his own taste. And then he says here, but this source that he's working on, at least for Genesis, was neither J nor E, but one related to them. Now, what the heck does that mean?
Where is this?
It's at the bottom of that. It's top of page 154. Last sentence of the paragraph. If four editions are the same. So he's saying, okay, the older authors, Janie, are really not authors, but merely collectors. That's what you were reading before, right? While P is a genuine. And yet he would be wrong if we should assume that he deliberately invented his allegations in Genesis. Tradition is too strong to permit him even to do this. On the contrary, he worked over the material, though very vigorously indeed, blah, blah, blah. But this source that he's working on, at least for Genesis, was neither J nor E, but one related to them. That I don't get at all.
Well, read what he says right before that. We can, so even though it looks like he very vigorously edited blah, 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 Janie, he says, we can often recognize by details how he followed his source in the general outline of events when no personal interest of his own was involved. So yeah, it seems like he's talking about P using another source.
Yeah, so maybe he went into more detail in the rest of the book, but that's...
He does. He says he refers page 139 of the commentary, which that must be the other section of Genesis.
Okay.
I'm assuming.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I thought that was some other book, but I think...
It might be. I don't know.
No, I think you're right.
So, yeah, that's interesting. I'll have to follow up on that, too.
Yeah, you're going to have to translate that.
Then he goes on to the age of the priestly codex. He says, P is the documentary witness of a time which was consciously moving away from the old traditions and which believed it necessary to lay the foundation of religion in a way differing from that of the fathers. And in P we have revealed the nature of this new element which had then assumed sway. It is the spirit of the learned priest that we here find expressed. Furthermore, this is also clear to us from the whole manner of P, and particularly from his formal language, that we have not here the work of an individual with a special tendency, but of a whole group whose convictions he expresses. So I don't think he's saying it was a committee. I think he's saying that P just represented widespread beliefs. Don't you think? Because he says, we have not here the work of an individual with a special tendency, but a whole group whose convictions he expresses.
Maybe. Sometimes it's easy to see things in terms of dynamic and special individuals. I guess that's even part of our culture.
Yeah.
But it's possible that, you know, it may have been a cultural tendency, but that doesn't mean that it coalesced into one guy that you can say was the P dude.
Yeah. Okay, so moving on. He says P was someone from the priesthood of Jerusalem, hence the name. Fellhausen revealed to us the time to which this spirit belonged. It came from a time following the great catastrophe to the people and the state of Judah, when the people, overwhelmed by tremendous impression of their measureless misfortune, recognized that their fathers had sinned and that a great religious reformation was necessary. Under powerful influence of the superior Babylonian civilization, Judaism also had acquired a taste for precise records of numbers and measures. It now grew accustomed to employ great care in statistical records. Genealogical tables were copied. Archives were searched for authentic documents. Chronological computations were undertaken. And even universal history was cultivated after the Babylonian model. So he's saying these tendencies, these exacting tendencies, came from exposure to Babylonian culture, especially Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles really show that. The emphasis laid by P upon the Sabbath, the prohibition of bloodshed and circumcision, is also comprehensible to us in the light of this period, the epic epoch in which everything depended on the willingness of the individual, emphasized the religious commandments which applied to the individual. P's religious criticism of mixed marriages also, especially those with Canaanitish women, whereby the blessing of Abraham was forfeited, connect with the same time, when the Jews living in the dispersion, or the diaspora, I guess, right? Same thing. Mm-hmm. Had no more zealous desire than to keep their blood and their religion pure.
I was saying that this is going on while they are in Babylon? That this is when this stuff is coming together?
I'm getting that feeling, yeah.
Yeah. Because I don't think it necessarily has to be during that time. It could even be after that time.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the moral story of, say, like the Deuteronomic history about all the bad kings and all the bad stuff that happened to them, could be, you know, during the Persian period when it was not a good idea to think in terms of nationalism, but rather being subjected to Persia. So, you know, it's not a good idea for any country to have kings. And how do you go about that? You create propaganda that shows how bad kingship was, mm-hmm. whether it even occurred or not, different story. But, you know, you can say that a lot of that can also come from that period when you have an elite that doesn't want to mix with the people of the land, you know, because they've been sent there to, in effect, you know, practice a different religion. It was not the same religion as the people were practicing that were living there at the time, obviously. And by implication, it may never have been. You know, it was a complete and total innovation at that period.
Yeah.
So you could easily say that this stuff was exactly the same concerns of the Persian and post-Persian periods.
Yeah.
Oh, did you catch that at the top of page 156? Skipping ahead a little bit, where it says P dealt largely with, it's the end of the paragraph, he dealt largely with mythical or legendary materials and are consequently inadequate according to our modern notions. In this respect, P may be compared to Berosus. Now, do you remember us discussing that book, Berosus in Genesis, Manetho in Exodus?
No, I don't, no.
But basically, the guy's theory was that you can explain all the Mesopotamian legends incorporated into Genesis as coming not directly from Mesopotamia or any other place, but wholesale reworking of one particular author, namely Berossus for the myths of Genesis and Manetho for the information for Exodus. So I just thought it was interesting. I was just thinking it was interesting that he had called attention to that
What's
analogy.
What's the name of that book again?
It's called Berossus in Genesis, Manetho in Exodus.
Berossus and Genesis?
In.
Oh, in Genesis.
Oh, I just thought it was
really
interesting.
Old book.
No, it's actually new.
Berossus in Genesis. It's not on Amazon.
It is, yes. It should be.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway, I'm gonna keep going here. I will look that book up in a bit.
It was just interesting that he mentioned that, though. I thought, oh.
Yeah, that is. I mean, because obviously, I wonder if he expands on that later on in the commentary.
That would be interesting to find out.
Yeah. Okay, so more about the dating. We need not attempt to determine here in just what century P wrote, but this much may be said, that the law book of Ezra, in the opinion of many scholars upon which the congregation took the oath in 444, and in the composition of which Ezra was in some way involved, was P. So he's thinking that P was a work of Ezra in some part, or that Ezra had a hand in its construction, I guess. Hence, we may place the composition of the book in the period from 500 to 444. P, too, was not completed all at once, though this is hardly a matter of importance so far as Genesis goes. Okay, now the final redactor. So this is the guy who had J, E, and P, and edit all of them in one go, or whatever, edit them all together. The final redactor, who combined the older work of J, E, and P, and designated as R, J, E, P, so redactor J, E, P, probably belongs, therefore, to the time of Ezra, and surely before the time of the separation of the Samaritan congregation, which carried the complete Pentateuch along with it, though we are unable, indeed, to give the exact date of this event.
Mm-hmm.
He says, the fact that such a combination of the older and the later collections was necessary shows us that the old legends had been planted too deep in the popular heart to be supplanted by the new spirit. The attempt of P to supplant the older tradition had proven a failure. Accordingly, a reverent hand produced a combination of J, E, and P. And then he goes on and lists some spots where he thinks you can identify the hand of the final redactor.
Very few.
Yeah, not that many.
I don't know, what do you think of that idea, though, that, P was trying to erase the history, but then he was a total failure and somebody else came along and made a more coherent and balanced creation out of it?
I kind of like that idea. I mean, I think Gunkel is a little harsh on P, but I think he has a good point in that, this really older material was not automatically jiving with the new religious consciousness of Israelites. And I think P did, go to work big time in trying to minimize at least a lot of that older stuff. And because, like he said, it was so important to so many people that you couldn't just expunge it completely, and that the final attempt was somehow to harmonize all this stuff together, J, E, and P, into one whole acceptable work. So I kind of like that reconstruction of the history, personally. What do you think? What do you guys think?
I'm not to the point where I can actually make much comment on it or criticize it now, but it's things I'm going to keep in mind for when I'm reading later. I'm going to read through these in Richard Elliot Friedman's The Bible with Sources Revealed and see all the individual sources and keep what Gunkel's saying in mind, and maybe a couple months from now I might have better comments on it.
Okay. Anything, John?
Yeah, I don't know what to make of that. yeah, like I said, I could see where if you agree with Gunkel on P, that, you know, why isn't it where you just have P, you know, and everything else just fell into the garbage heap. So, yeah, somebody coming along and wanting to salvage things and put things together. It's hard to imagine, though. Well, maybe you can't imagine a period of time where people had a change of ideas. So, yeah, historically, could have been. Yeah, I keep an open mind on that.
Okay, so one final part remains in the book. A quick comment on the traditional attribution of Mosaic authorship, that Moses wrote the Pentateuch. It's real short. I'm just going to read the whole thing. How Genesis came to be attributed to Moses. One word more in closing as to how Genesis has obtained the undeserved honor of being regarded as a work of Moses. From primitive times, there existed a tradition in Israel that the divine ordinances regarding worship, law, and morality, as proclaimed by the mouth of the priests, were derived from Moses. When, then, these ordinances, which had originally circulated orally, were written down in larger or smaller works, it was natural that they passed under the name of Moses. Now our Pentateuch consists, in addition to the collection of legends, of such books of law from various periods and of very diverse spirit. And because the legends also, from the time of the Exodus, have to do chiefly with Moses, it was very easy to combine both legends and laws in one single book. Thus it happened that Genesis has become the first part of a work whose following parts tell chiefly of Moses and contain many laws that claim to come from Moses. But in its contents, Genesis has no connection with Moses. These narratives, among them so many of a humorous and artistic or a sentimental character, are very remote from the spirit of such a strenuous and wrathful titan as Moses, according to the tradition, must have been. The end.
We all get gold stars, huh?
Yep. You all get an A+. So, any thoughts on the book overall, now that we're done with it? Do you guys think it's sorely outdated? Were there any major points of disagreement with him? Anything? Did you get anything from him, valuable from him, that you learned, or did he just reinforce stuff that you already believed? What did you guys think about it overall?
I think what you said, the last part, I agree with. It seems like even the points of disagreement helped me better understand what I do think.
Okay.
I don't think it's as obsolete, you know, as I originally would have thought when I was reading the first couple chapters. I think a lot of this content has stood the test of time. And he makes a lot of arguments that even the minimalists today have to address. In fact, I'm actually glad I've heard some of Gunkel's arguments here. So back Thomas Thompson or something later, I know, well, how do you deal with Gunkel saying this? You know, I kind of know where the bar is set that they have to meet.
Okay. Yeah, that's something I need to really catch up on. I know virtually nothing about minimalism, so. But I like the book overall. I really liked his different criteria for identifying the apparent ages of the legends, you know, the real primitive stuff versus the stuff that, you know, he says you can trace kind of the development of Israelitish religion, to use his weird word, Israelitish, you know, coming when it hits monotheism, you get a different conception of God, a more abstract remote god, whereas before you basically have monolatry where, yeah, there's different gods, of course, we just worship Yahweh, and God's more immediate in the world and all that stuff. I really like that stuff. The source stuff I really like, but again, I have to really read minimalism more to see how it jives with that. But overall, I really like the book. So,
one thing I thought is that he was talking about these various source legends and so forth. And then he talks about P creating a chronology for it, and then the final redactor kind of refining that and putting everything into kind of a history, in a sense. You know, the big problem I have with that is that we like to think in terms of evolution, and we like to see, you know, lower forms evolving into higher forms. But a lot of that, I think, is because of the way this material is constructed, that perhaps some of that evolution of religions, what Gunkel sees, his school of religions thing, is in some way illusory because of the way the material is organized.
Yeah, that's possible.
So my big problem is with his theological approach. I think, you know, the other things are, I don't have a problem with. I do agree with Wayne, is that I tend to see this stuff more as literary sources than, you know, the importance of them being written down and so forth, rather than being traditions and things like that, being oral. Because you really can't get back to the orality anymore. You know, what did it look like before it was written down?
Yeah. Okay, well, anyway, that was Legends of Genesis by Hermann Gunkel, and next week, next Sunday, let's just keep it at roughly 7:30 p.m. Pacific, we're going to be reading Parables of War by John W. Marshall, and after we go off live, we can discuss how much reading we should assign, but anyway, yeah. So we have a Facebook group. If anyone stumbles across this on YouTube or is watching it or was watching it or will watch it, we have a Facebook group on, Facebook group, Society of Biblical Scholarship. And, hope to see more people come in here.